Part 3. The Road to Eleusis. The Road of Excess Leads to the Palace of Wisdom. William Blake. Chapter 8. Catch a Fire. The Sandbox of the Future. If gizmos and gadgets are your thing, then the annual Consumer Electronics Show in Las Vegas is your pilgrimage. If it's superheroes and graphic novels, then it's San Diego's Comic-Con. But if you're stalking ecstasis, if you want to see the four forces cranked up and deployed for full effect, then head out to that same desert festival Larry Page and Sergey Brin used to screen Eric Schmidt, Burning Man. Every year, some 3 hours northeast of Reno, on a vast alkali flat known as the Black Rock Desert, you'll find all the major players from part two of this book. There's Tony Andrews in Purple Paisley, bumping bass out of a Function 1 art car. Mikey Siegel's around, too, demonstrating neurofeedback to the dusty and the curious. Android Jones has erected a giant dome to display his trance-inducing visionary art. There are workshops by world-renowned sex therapists, lectures on neurotheology by Ivy League scientists, and every head-bending alphabetamine Sasha Shulgin ever dreamed up. Off in the distance, you might even spot the Red Bull Air Force, dressed up in flaming costumes and wingsuiting into the city. Whatever else can be said about the event, Burning Man holds the undisputed title as the world's largest ecstatic trade show. Burning Man aggressively extends the tradition of hedonic ecstasy. One writes Eric Davis, visuals, disorienting sonics, and a self-conscious excess of sensory stimulation all help undermine stabilized frames. Full sensorium brain machine designed to bring us in tune with our mind's ongoing construction of real-time on the fly. Michael Michaels, one of Burning Man's original founders too, explains it this way: at Burning Man, we've found a way to break out of the box that confines us. What we do, literally, is take people's reality and break it apart. Burning Man is a transformation engine. It has hardware and it has software. You can adjust it and tweak it. And we've done that. We take people out to this vast dry place. Nowhere, very harsh conditions. It strips away their luggage, the things they've brought with them, of who they thought they were. And it puts them in a community setting where they have to connect with each other, in a place where anything is possible. In doing so, it breaks their old reality and helps them realize they can create their own. In other words, it's a transformation engine tailor-made to invoke the selflessness, timelessness, effortlessness, and richness of STER. Increasingly, that transformation engine has been producing real change in the world. And that's the point of this chapter. If the past section examined the emergence of the four forces, this one asks the next obvious question: is the radical inspiration the forces provide leading to practical innovation? Earlier, we explored studies that demonstrated non-ordinary states can meaningfully boost creativity and problem-solving under controlled conditions. Here, we want to step outside the lab and see if ecstasy is helping solve wicked problems in the wild. And Burning Man is perhaps the best place to begin this inquiry. The first thing to note is who's showing up at the festival. Unlike in the Woodstock era, attendees are no longer just countercultural bohemians who have tuned in, turned on, and dropped out. For sure, there are still plenty of punk anarchists, industrial artists, and warehouse denizens for whom life in the mainstream is a sometimes awkward fit. But today, the ranks of burners, as attendees call themselves, include members of a high-powered subculture, a technomatic glitterati that have access to capital, markets, and global communication platforms. When Tim Ferriss mentioned that nearly all of the billionaires he knows in Silicon Valley take psychedelics to help themselves solve complex problems, Burning Man is one of their preferred locations to step out and go big. If you haven't been, you just don't get Silicon Valley, three serial entrepreneur and longtime attendee Elon Musk noted in Ray Code. You could take the craziest law party and multiply it by 1,000, and it doesn't even get fucking close. Among certain circles, mention of the Playa or Black Rock City gains you instant camaraderie with those who have shared that baptism by fire. Participation in successful Burning Man camps has morphed from countercultural street cred to career-building material. So embedded, so accepted has Burning Man become for in parts of tech culture, wrote journalist Vanessa Hua in the San Francisco Chronicle, that the event alters work rhythms, shows up on resumes, is even a sanctioned form of professional development, all signs that the norm has adopted parts of the formerly deviant happening. Over the last decade in particular, the festival has become a regular stop for those whose calendar might include Davos, TED, and a slew of other high-profile gatherings. In 2013, John Perry Barlow, a fellow at Harvard Law School 5 and former lyricist for the Grateful Dead, casually tweeted from Burning Man, spent much of the afternoon in conversation with Larry Harvey, mayor of Burning Man, and General Wesley Clark, who is here, At one of the more infamous parties on the planet, countercultural royalty are hobnobbing with a former supreme commander of NATO turned US presidential candidate. 3 years later, the actual president, 6 Barack Obama, joked about the event at the White House Correspondents Association dinner, saying, "Just recently, a young person came up to me and said she was sick of politicians standing in the way of her dreams. As if we were actually going to let Malia go to Burning Man this year. Was not going to happen. Bernie might have let her go. Not us." If the president of the United States is moved to comment on the event, and Elon Musk is claiming it's central to Silicon Valley culture, then perhaps there's more going on than just a week-long party. And that's the second thing to explore in our assessment. Why so many creative and talented people go so far out of their way to congregate there once a year? By simple elimination, it can't just be the sex, drugs, or music. Those indulgences, however tantalizing, are little more than commodities in any major city. There must be a pretty compelling something that inspires people to take a week out of their calendars to wander around an inhospitable salt flat in the middle of absolute nowhere. Recent research conducted on Burning Man sheds some light on that something. In 2015, a team of scientists led by Oxford neuropsychologist Molly Crockett Seven joined forces with the Black Rock City Census to take a closer look at the festival's power. In their study, 75% of attendees reported having a transformative experience at the event, while 85% of those reported that the benefits persisted for weeks and months afterward. That's an incredibly high batting average. 3 out of 4 people who attend the event are meaningfully changed by it. And this doesn't just happen by accident. Wandering out into the middle of that intentional chaos at 2 a.m., surrounded by fire-spewing dinosaurs, giant neon-lit pirate ships, and the throbbing beats of galactic hip-hop, you're ripped away from all familiar reference points, totally unstuck in time, and well beyond normal awareness. The wildness of the event. The radical self-reliance it requires, the ability to create and inhabit larger-than-life alter egos, all combined to create a temporary autonomous Zone 8. A place where people can step outside themselves and become, if only for a brief week, whatever they desire. It's the single greatest concentration of state-altering technology on the planet. Designed by everyone together and no one in particular. Which brings us to the final and most important category in our assessment. The astonishing amount of innovation this event consistently inspires. Attendees treat the playa as an oversized sandbox. A place where ideas can be dreamed up, tested out, and, as often as not, shared freely with everyone. "I like going to Burning Man," Google founder Larry Page 9 said at the 2013 Google I/O conference. "An environment where people can try new things. I think as technologists, we should have some safe places where we can try out things and figure out the effect on society, the effect on people, without having to deploy it to the whole world." In 2007, Elon Musk did just that, debuting an early prototype 10 of his Tesla electric Roadster at the event. He also came up with the Ideas 11 for both his renewable energy company SolarCity and his superfast transit system Hyperloop while on the playa. And true to the Burning Man principle of gifting, he gave both away. SolarCity went to his cousins. Hyperloop, published online in a white paper, was an offering to the world at large. Zappos founder and CEO Tony Hsieh 12 told Playboy that the experience of collective awareness, what he calls the hive switch, is the reason he attends. That feeling of unity with the other people in the space. Unity with the music and with one another. "That's why I go to Burning Man." For Hsieh, the festival has had such an impact that he's built its ideas into the corporate culture of Zappos, reorganizing the company to make flipping the hive switch as easy as possible. Similarly, he's also spearheaded the Downtown Project, an attempt to revitalize central Las Vegas with radical inclusion, interactive art, and other core elements of the festival. While much has been made of the fact that Hsieh's efforts have faced setbacks 13 and challenges, it would be surprising if things went differently. Hsieh has taken ideas pioneered at Burning Man and is attempting to reinvent the culture of a Fortune 500 company and to reinvigorate a blighted urban core. That structural change in the real world, with all the risks and complications it entails. Musk projects too aren't without their complications, but reinventing transportation and pioneering a new energy grid are wicked enough problems that they've stymied all prior efforts to solve them. What these examples make clear is that the perspective provided by non-ordinary consciousness and culture offers a different path forward. A way to reconsider intractable challenges with fresh eyes. All of these practical applications have, in turn, inspired the Burning Man organization itself. A few years ago, we attended the event to speak at their annual TEDx series and then got invited to a small salon hosted by Danger Ranger. And it wasn't just Silicon Valley tech titans in attendance. Senior vice presidents from Goldman Sachs, Heads of the largest creative ad agencies in the world and leaders of the World Economic Forum were all discreetly there. Using fanciful assumed names, far from the flashbulbs and scrutiny of the media and the markets, their goal was to forge a future based on the shared experience of communities writ large. A permanent Burning Man community, a place where experiments with the four forces could be conducted year-round. As Burning Man co-founder Will Roger recently wrote, "I would argue that the proposal is part of a large strain of utopian separatism that can be found in the modern tech boom, Peter Thiel's seasteading efforts or Tony Hsieh's attempt to build a startup city in Las Vegas. But a Burning Man permanent community would arguably be the most interesting and achievable manifestation of it." 14. In the summer of 2016, they achieved just that, closing on the purchase of Fly Ranch, a parcel of nearly 4,000 acres a few miles north of the festival site, filled with geysers, hot springs, and wetlands. This is all part of the evolution of Burning Man. 15. The organization announced, from an ephemeral experiment into a global cultural movement having an impact on social, economic, and artistic norms and structures. Burning Man's culture is becoming more recognized and influential around the world. When the levee breaks. One of the more interesting parts of this story isn't simply that burners are trying to establish a homeland for ecstasis. It's that some of the hardest and grittiest lessons of building a city from scratch are showing up thousands of miles beyond the Nevada desert. So, if we want to continue our exploration of how non-ordinary states are helping to solve wicked problems in the wild, then we should head to some of the wildest places on Earth, those ravaged by natural disasters and protracted war, to better understand how a week-long gathering could have such far-reaching impact. It's important to understand that in preparation for the event, all the central Burning Man organization does is survey the streets and put out porta-potties. Everything else about the makeshift city. The camps, the giant art, the generators, the medical facilities, and the peacekeeping is organized by volunteers. In coming together to create a city of 70,000. Burners are pioneering fundamentally different ways of organizing and mobilizing people in the face of some of the harshest conditions on the planet, and they're using the bonding power of communities to do it. One of the first times those skills truly got put to the test was in 2005. It was August 29th. And over on the Gulf Coast, Hurricane Katrina was less than an hour from making landfall. By the time the storm was over, it would spread $108 billion of damage, 16 from Florida to Texas, and earn the dark honor of being one of the five worst hurricanes in U.S. history, over in Nevada. Meanwhile, it was sunny skies and light winds, and Burning Man was in full swing. Camp Plagon was bustling. A collection of high-ranking Pentagon officials, futurists, and hackers, Plagon had been charged with setting up and running the livestream broadcast and emergency Wi-Fi for the entire festival. But when news of Katrina reached them, they took a break from their duties to get a closer look. One of our guys took over a recon satellite. 17 recounts Dr. Bruce Damer, a University of California biomedical engineer and NASA contractor. Our Pentagon wireless satellite phone rang. The general on the other side was saying what's going on and instructing our guy not to answer. We then had control of this thing and could watch Katrina come in. And never ones to miss an opportunity for a high-tech prank. The Plagon crew lit dozens of hydrazine flares around their camp and programmed the satellite to track the blaze from space, too. But those real-time feeds of Katrina lashing the Gulf Coast had a sobering impact. The citizens of Plagon wanted to help. So did plenty of other burners. After gathering more than $40,000 in relief money from concerned attendees, an advanced team left the festival, drove down to the Gulf Coast, and got to work. With Doctors Without Borders as their inspiration. 18 They dubbed their nascent organization Burners Without Borders. At the time, New Orleans was getting all the national attention, but these burners decided to focus their efforts on coastal towns in Mississippi, which had been equally damaged but largely ignored. The first thing they did was set up shop in a parking lot and build a much-needed distribution center for established charities like Oxfam and the Red Cross. Then, over the course of 8 months, they donated more than $1 million in debris removal and reconstruction efforts. The organization did everything from restore a Vietnamese temple in Biloxi to raise and rebuild the entire town of Pearlington. As CNET noted, this was no ragtag group of 10 to 20 hopeless do-gooders showing up without a plan. This was more than 150 people, toting heavy equipment, supplies of food and water, years of experience surviving and thriving in harsh, off-the-grid environments. Before leaving, they teamed up with local residents to build a giant sculpture out of flood debris and, true to form, turned it to ash in a giant, cathartic bonfire. Our town was destroyed and we were abandoned by our government and our leadership. One Pearlington resident said, but came in and reminded us that even in all that devastation was the chance for art, for celebration and for community. Since that time, Burners Without Borders has become an international organization active in disaster zones from Peru's 2007 earthquake to Japan's Fukushima disaster to New Jersey's Hurricane Sandy. And the relationships they've forged with locals in those areas have come full circle, with leaders from those communities coming to Burning Man in subsequent years to learn where all of that capability and enthusiasm comes from. In an even less likely example of Burning Man's spreading impact, Dr. Dave Warner exported its core ethos to war-torn Afghanistan. In 2011, Warner, a data visualization expert and the guy who had hacked the Katrina satellite, was in Jalalabad, just 30 miles from the caves of Tora Bora where Osama bin Laden had given U.S. forces the slip a decade earlier. A large man with long, graying hair and beard, Warner has a resume 19 that reads, former U.S. Army drill instructor, PhD neuroscientist, technotopian idealist, dedicated burner, dabbler in psychedelics, insatiable meddler and defense contractor, Warner and a gang of MIT scientists, who called themselves the Synergy Strike Force, had posted up in Jalalabad to spread the gospel of open information. Based on the Burning Man principle of radical inclusion, Warner insisted that all Synergy Strike Force projects remain unclassified and that the information be shared with everyone. I'm dismantling the Death Star. 20, he told a war reporter, to build solar ovens for Yuaks. So, Warner opened a burner bar, where he traded free drinks for terabytes of information. It was more of a tiki hut. Really, covered in bamboo, a simple cooler with some Heineken and the odd bottle of liquor displayed, but also a sign that read, "We share information, communication," in their intelligence gathering. No detail was too small: reconstruction projects, troop movements, construction plans, hydrology surveys, health clinic locations, polling sites, names of local farmers, even crops those farmers were planting. Warner took all the information from his Beer for Data program and plugged it into a data visualization tool he had created. The results outperformed every three-letter agency you can think of. And because Warner had refused a security clearance, he could gift anyone who asked with these results. Lots of people asked. The Pentagon relied on his data. But so did the United Nations, Afghan officials, aid workers, and journalists. In one of the most chaotic environments in the world, gifting, transparency, and radical inclusion saved lives and dollars. While Burners Without Borders and Beer for Data mark two of the earliest examples of festival principles being exported into crisis zones, they're unlikely to be the last. With so much experience in self-organizing their own municipal infrastructure, 21 in a hostile environment, former Apple executive Peter Hirschberg wrote in his book From Bitcoin to Burning Man and Beyond, burners are particularly skilled at functioning during chaotic crises when normal services, running water, electricity, communication channels, and sanitation systems are not available. Burners don't just survive in such an environment. They create culture, art, and community there. It's for this reason that Rosie von Lila, 22, a former head of community affairs for the Burning Man organization, has been invited to the Pentagon three times and the United Nations twice to discuss infrastructure and disaster planning. I've been amazed at the depth of interest, von Lila says. Traditional organizations are realizing the limitations of top-down mobilization and are seriously studying how bottoms-up community mobilization, the core lessons of the Burning Man community, can be deployed in critical environments. Or, really, in any kind of environment. Burning Man demonstration projects can be seen everywhere, from 23 solar power installations on rural Indian reservations to experimental community spaces in blighted metropolitan areas, the generator in Reno, Nevada, to smartphone apps. And because burners vigorously defend an open-source, non-commercial approach, their efforts are easy to share and hard to censor. Burning Man regional burns now occur in nearly 30 countries, from Israel to South Africa to Japan, providing global access to the experience. It's been called a countercultural diaspora. But that might be too limiting. After all, what's countercultural about disaster relief, intelligence gathering, and urban planning? These projects all provided creative solutions to persistently wicked problems, ones that defied the best-laid plans of the most powerful militaries, governments, and aid agencies on the planet. Relying on the ingenuity, collaboration, and relentless hard work of a community forged by ecstasy, burners are extending their impact well beyond the celebration that birthed them. Burning Man didn't invent the festival, 20 for the art car, or the temporary autonomous zone any more than Apple invented the personal computer, continues Hirschberg. But like that other venturesome innovator, Burning Man executed the concept beautifully, and through its work is having an outsized impact on our culture and quite possibly on our future, disrupting the Brahmins. While Burning Man principles and skills are being deployed in some of the harshest conditions on Earth by volunteers with limited budgets, a large number of the examples in this chapter have involved the creative class, That is, people with the resources, influence, and time needed for such pursuits. And typically, that's the way these things have always worked, at least as far back as the Eleusinian Mysteries, which counted notables such as Plato and Pythagoras among its members. Ecstatic culture has often been spread by an educated elite. In Europe, we saw this with the Rabelaisians 25 of the 16th century and the Club de Hashish in the 18th century, both of whom explored altered states, open sexuality, and libertine philosophies in pursuit of inspiration. In the 1920s, socialite Mabel Dodge Lewenstow's Home 26 served as a mescaline-fueled salon for everyone from D.H. Lawrence to Georgie O'Keeffe and Carl Jung. In the 1960s, Esalen's founders and faculty infused Bohemia with academia. 27 drawing heavily from the ranks of Stanford, Harvard, and the European intellectual community. Yet, even though these movements all began with a select few, they ended up having a disproportionate impact on philosophy, art, and culture. In July 2013, we experienced a contemporary instance of this dynamic in the mountains of Utah, where a small but influential group of innovators are building community based on what they call the power of shared peak experiences 28, guided by John Batista and his New Orleans marching band. We found ourselves in a large crowd of artists, activists, and entrepreneurs traipsing through an aspen forest. After about 30 minutes, the procession arrived at a wildflower-strewn meadow and the largest dinner table either of us had ever seen. It was a quarter mile long, a single straight line stretching across the whole of the hillside, with white linen place settings for 1,000. As we sat down, we noticed all the little details expressly designed to prompt awe and delight, like hand-crank radios playing jazz from a pirate AM station and stainless steel whiskey flasks with Walt Whitman poetry inscribed on their side. The host proceeded to serve everyone by hand, laying out an inventive multi-course meal, then timed perfectly with the rising full moon to the east and the blazing sun setting in the west. Everyone raised a glass to the palpable sense of community present that night. After dinner, the entire forest transformed into a lit wonderland. Soundstages were playing everything from pulsing electronica to spoken word poetry. Butterfly and glowworm art cars buzzed soundlessly up and down the dirt path. And in the distance, scattered across the hillside, were the domes, tents, and pavilions that housed everyone gathered to connect and collaborate over this midsummer weekend. As much as the fingerprints of Burning Man were everywhere at this event, the remote setting, the glamour camping, the art, performance, and whimsy, there were two crucial differences. Not only did it take place at 9,000 feet above sea level, but it wasn't going to disappear at the end of a week. This summertime gathering was a coming-out party. Just 7 weeks earlier, the hosts, Summit Series, had bought the entire mountain. "We wanted a permanent home," 29 explained Summit co-founder Jeff Rosenthal. "We wanted to build a town dedicated to what altered states really can provide: creativity, collaboration, innovation, entrepreneurship, and community. And because our community shared that vision, we were able to crowdsource $40 million and buy a ski area that sits on a mountain range the size of Manhattan." So while folks at Burning Man are just starting to build themselves a homeland, Summit has already taken that step. Already, there are more than 500 home sites on the land, with people like Richard Branson, Kobe Bryant, JCMO Beth Comstock, and Nike president Trevor Edwards already committed to the project. And instead of the typical McMansion resort plan, they are actively fostering community by prohibiting oversized statement homes and concentrating development into tightly clustered neighborhoods. Everything is being built to platinum-level LEED environmental standards. It's the world's first ecstatically inspired eco-town. Though it didn't start out that way, Summit began in 2008, when five entrepreneurs in their early 20s came together to solve a common problem. They didn't know any really successful entrepreneurs and had no one to ask for advice. So the quintet came up with a creative solution. Cold call business leaders and asked them to go skiing. 19 people showed up, including Zappos's Tony Hsieh and Facebook co-founder Dustin Moskovitz. "We learned that when you take a bunch of really bright, diverse people," explains Rosenthal, "and let them share a dynamic, immersive experience, you get powerful results. Lifelong friendships were formed. It removed the tedious, transactional nature of networking. I guess you could say that one of the things we discovered on that trip was that altered states accelerate business." This one-off experiment soon became the Summit Series, a string of non-conferences built upon those original insights. The series, which has been called TED Crossed with Burning Man 30 or the Hipper Davos, has struck a chord. Summit's first event was a ski trip for 19 people. Their second event was a trip to Mexico for 60, and their third event was at the White House. After hearing about the organization, President Obama invited them to bring 35 young leaders to dinner for a discussion about millennial culture and the future of innovation, and what they shared at the White House, and have been implementing ever since, is a vision of social entrepreneurship that values both purpose and profits. Today, when Summit hosts a weekend, you'll find little-known entrepreneurs, activists, and artists mingling with the likes of Questlove, Eric Schmidt, and Martha Stewart. This kind of cross-pollination has produced some interesting collaborations. Summit mobilized a team of marine biologists, adventurers, and philanthropists to organize a Protect Our Oceans trip through the Caribbean and raised more than $2 million to establish a nature preserve. They've supported Pencils of Promise, a nonprofit dedicated to global K-12 education that's built almost 400 schools, and helped launch Falling Whistles, a global network of over 120,000 members dedicated to eradicating child soldiers in the Congo. But it's not just nonprofit work they're interested in. They've also begun a venture capital fund that has helped seed dozens of startups, including the Buy One, Give One Shoe Company Toms, the eyeglass upstart Warby Parker, and the ride-sharing giant Uber. By using non-ordinary states to promote community, they're reimagining the staid world of professional networking, philanthropy, and venture capital. And Summit isn't the only organization leveraging those lessons to accelerate change. Might I Global, started in 2006 by venture capitalist Bill Tai 31 and kitesurfing legend Susie Mai, uses action sports as a stimulant for group flow and entrepreneurship. Theirs is a potent partnership. Bill Tai sits on the boards of a half dozen of Silicon Valley's best-known companies, while Susie Mai is the only woman to be awarded lifetime status as a Red Bull athlete. Might I hosts multi-day gatherings that blend kiteboarding sessions, off-the-record conversations with founders, startup pitch marathons, and a transformational festival atmosphere. We curate our experiences very strategically. 32 explains Susie Mai. We find the right mix of really interesting people and subject them to powerful state-changing experiences that accelerate social bonding. It's the same formula used at Burning Man and at Summit. Mai also points out that there's a lot of crossover between these cultures. Very early on, we got a lot of support from the Burning Man community. Burners instinctively understood what we were trying to do, so they just started showing up. And it's a very participatory community. So when burners do show up, they build stuff, they start organizing, they get everyone involved. Very involved. To date, dozens of companies have leveraged the talent and contacts in the community to raise venture funding and find key partners. Most done with handshake deals on the beach, at the end of a great kiting session, when, as Tai says, everyone's feeling the stoke. They've also come to see action sports as a filter for startup success. We've noticed that learning to kitesurf has a lot of parallels with the challenges of entrepreneurship, Mai explains. If someone has the grit and presence of mind required by the sport, then it shows a lot about their character and how they show up more broadly in life. And the parallels aren't just conceptual. Over the years, Mai Tai members have founded and led companies with an aggregate market value of more than $20 billion, 33 making them one of the more influential groups of entrepreneurs in the world. Building on these insights, Mai Tai recently created the Extreme Technology Challenge. Rather than having promising startups pound the pavement in the hunt for funding, the challenge gathers them together at the Consumer Electronics Show in Las Vegas for a pitch fest meant to invert this process. Instead of droves of founders showing up for a series of 30 minute meetings with venture capitalists, explains Tai, and those funders then having to backdoor vet prospective leaders, we spend real time together in an environment where a person's true character is revealed. Finalists receive an invite to Richard Branson's Caribbean hideaway, Necker Island, where, between kitesurfing sessions, they get to pitch Branson himself on Necker. As at Burning Man and Summit's Powder Mountain, everything is deliberately designed to create communities. We experienced this firsthand, 30, for when we were invited to the island to talk about flow and entrepreneurship. From the cliffside zip lines that carry you to breakfast, to the stunning Balinese-inspired architecture, to a broad menu of action sports, everything is built to trigger that state of effortless focus. When I do, Branson told us over smoothies on his back porch one morning, I get an extra 2 hours of great work done, and the other 12 are really, really productive. So trying to get that balance in life is really important, not saying that one shouldn't party hard as well. Branson and Mai Tai are taking this same approach to host the Carbon War Room, a transnational organization 35 dedicated to energy sustainability in the Caribbean, and the Blockchain Summit, an international consortium exploring socially beneficial applications for alternative currencies. By bringing the passionate and talented together to play and work, they're charting a course toward a more innovative and sustainable future. Case in point, A cedar hot tub perched on the crow's nest of the main house of Necker Island. Guests gather there to soak, talk, and gaze at the stars, and it was at one of those late-night gatherings that Branson birthed his most ambitious company yet. That's where I had the idea for Virgin Galactic. 36, he reflects. NASA hadn't yet created a spaceship I could fly on, and if I waited too long, I wouldn't be around. So I thought, let's build our own. I mean, who in their right mind wouldn't look up at those stars and not dream of going there? And getting innovators into their right minds is what Summit, might I and Branson have done so well, by realizing that non-ordinary states are more than just a recreational diversion and can, in fact, heighten trust, amplify cooperation, and accelerate breakthroughs. A new generation of entrepreneurs, philanthropists, and activists is fundamentally disrupting business as usual. High times on Main Street. If the only evidence of the four forces showing up in the world was to be found at exotic gatherings for a fortunate few, their impact would remain severely constrained, trickle-down ecstasis. But what is emerging is more varied than that. The ripple effects of these innovators' companies and projects are even beginning to show up on Main Street itself. And they're following a predictable pattern of dissemination. In his seminal book 37 Crossing the Chasm, Geoffrey Moore outlined exactly how new ideas gain traction. At first, when breakthroughs happen, only those people willing to tolerate the risk and uncertainty of a novel technology get on board, a trade they'll make for the benefits of being early adopters. Then there's a gap, what Moore called the chasm, that any idea has to cross to attract a growing audience. It's attracting that early majority on the far side of the chasm that he feels is the true mark of disruptive innovation. Up until now, we've focused primarily on the pioneers and early adopters, those most visibly driving the evolution of the four forces. Here we want to take a moment to catalog signs of broader applications, focusing on the places where the chasm has been crossed and a critical early majority are starting to incorporate state-changing tools and techniques into their everyday lives. Take the first force, psychology. Thanks to the work of Martin Seligman and others, a new generation of positive psychologists is repackaging meditation, stripping out its spiritual connotations and providing evidence-based validation for its benefits. This new version, known as mindfulness-based stress reduction, is gaining traction in places that would never have embraced earlier variants. 18 million Americans now have a regular practice. 38 and, by the end of 2017, 44% of all U.S. companies will offer mindfulness 39 training to employees. Since rolling out their program, Aetna estimates 40 that it's saved $2,000 per employee in health care costs and gained $3,000 per employee in productivity. This quantifiable return on investment helps explain why the meditation and mindfulness industry grew to nearly $1 billion 41 in 2015. What had been the domain of seekers and swamis is now a staple of HR, and the impact of positive psychology is spreading well beyond the workplace. At Harvard, Professor Tal Ben-Shahar's 40-day course on happiness is the most popular in the university's history, while mainstream books on the science of well-being consistently top the bestseller lists. And this focus on optimal living isn't just bettering our mood, it's advancing our growth. One of Bob Keegan's graduate students recently determined that by college, many millennials have reached stages of adult development 43 that took their parents until middle age to attain. We're seeing similar progress in neurobiology, legitimized by discoveries in embodied cognition. Contemplative physical practices like yoga, tai chi, and qigong have become the most popular indoor activities in the United States. Consider yoga. This 5,000-year-old tradition was a countercultural pastime until the 1990s. But once researchers began finding the practice did everything 44 from improve cognitive function to decrease blood pressure, the general public started to cross the chasm. As of 2015, some 36 million Americans have a regular practice 45, an activity that changes our state of mind by changing the shape of our bodies has become more popular, in terms of participation, than football 46. On the higher tech end of the spectrum, state-changing treatments like transcranial magnetic stimulation are now outperforming antidepressants, and many Silicon Valley executives are going off-label, using the technology to defrag their mental hard drives and boost performance. Companies like Dave Asprey's Bulletproof Executive are helping people biohack their daily lives with everything from smart sensors to nootropics. This market is expanding so rapidly that Bulletproof has grown into a nine-figure enterprise 47 in less than 4 years, and hundreds of other companies are flooding into the market. In pharmacology, we're increasingly accepting of substances that shift our consciousness. Marijuana, once called a demon weed, has become the fastest growing industry 48 in America. The whole of the cannabis economy 49 is now worth roughly $6.2 billion. and slated to rise to $22 billion by 2020. As of late 2016, 28 states have legalized medical marijuana, and 8 of them, Colorado, Washington, Oregon, Nevada, California, Massachusetts, and Alaska, and the District of Columbia, have legalized recreational use as well. Over the next 5 years, researchers believe another 14 states will follow suit. As Peter Reuter, a University of Maryland drug policy professor, recently told CNN, 50 I'm surprised by the long-term increase in support for marijuana legalization. It's unprecedented. It doesn't look like a blip. And cannabis is merely the most obvious sign of this change. Whether we're examining psychedelics like LSD, or empathogens like MDMA, mind-altering drugs are more popular than at any other time in history. 32 million Americans use psychedelics 51 on a regular basis and report considered reasons for doing so. According to a 2013 study published in a journal of the National Institutes of Health, 50 to the most common motivations are to enhance mystical experiences, introspection, and curiosity. Transcendence, not decadence, appears to be driving use forward. Technology has seen similar developments. A few decades ago, brain imaging devices were multi-million dollar machines available in only a handful of university labs. Today they've become as ubiquitous and accessible as the smartphones in our pockets. With a handful of plug-and-play sensors, we can now measure hormones, heart rates, brainwaves, and respiration and get much clearer pictures of our real-time health. In the summer of 2016, for example, Jay Blonick, the lead designer of the Apple Watch, gave us an early look at their product roadmap. Over the next few years, the watch will connect these sensors to become a platform for open-source research into everything from obesity to peak performance. In one 24-hour beta test, more than 30,000 people volunteered to contribute their personal data to Alzheimer's research, making it 4 times the size of the next largest study overnight. And Apple is only part of a larger trend. Between 2000 and 2009, companies filed fewer than 400 patents for Neurotech 53. That number doubled in 2010 and doubled again in 2016. With the data these devices are providing, we can shortcut our way not only to better health, but to deeper self-awareness, taking weeks and months to train what used to take yogis and monks decades to master. While these are all examples of the four forces reaching deeper into the mainstream majority, they may already seem unremarkable. There's a reason for this. Rakers Weil, the director of engineering at Google, once pointed out that it's hard for non-scientists to track progress in artificial intelligence because, when it shows up in the real world, it looks like nothing fancier than a talking ATM. It's true for ecstasy as well. Soccer moms with kundalini yoga practices, businessmen microdosing psychedelics, tech nerds tracking biometrics, The Simpsons going to Burning Man, these developments might seem pedestrian. But they are the talking ATMs of altered states. They are proof that the chasm has been crossed, that the once cutting edge is now integrated into the everyday. Nothing new under the sun. Under the hot August sun, in the western wilds of America, tens of thousands of misfits gather to worship and celebrate. These seekers are there because they reject the stuffiness of their parents' religion but are equally uninspired by the godlessness of their transient society. They crave direct mystical experience, and they have come together to find it. They stay up all night dancing, 50 for playing music, getting intoxicated, and crowding together to see the headlining performers, standing on giant scaffolds. These artists whip the crowds into a collective trance. When the mood takes them, and it often does, attendees have sex under the open sky. Afterward, when they go back to their regular lives, they transform the world as they know it. On fire with their recent initiation, they challenge existing social, political, and spiritual conventions. So noticeable are their efforts that the towns and cities where they congregate are called burned-over districts. There was a time and a place when this all happened, but it wasn't the present day and it wasn't the Black Rock Desert. The date was 1801. The place was Cane Ridge, Kentucky. The occasion was the Second Great Awakening, one of the largest spiritual revivals in American history. The ink was barely dry on the Constitution, and the western boundary of the United States reached only as far as the Appalachians, but already the foundation of a vibrant American ecstatic tradition was being laid. Those gathered in Cane Ridge were part of the largest revival of that era. More than 20,000 settlers camped out, listening to itinerant preachers who stood on elevated platforms to speak to the frenzied crowds of the coming rapture. In between sermons, people hung out by their tents and lean-tos, with fiddles and banjos, playing the Scots-Irish tunes that would later become bluegrass music. And despite the ostensibly pious intent of the gathering, there was plenty of drinking and fornicating, even back then. The Holy Ghost feeling was tough to keep under wraps. These revivals offered connection and community in a world that felt fragmented and hectic. Over the next half century, an entire generation of the young and passionate joined in. The Second Great Awakening gave birth to social justice movements ranging from temperance and women's rights to abolition. It infused American politics with an activist conscience for years to come. Even Joseph Smith's Hilltop Epiphany took place in one of those burned-over districts. So as we consider the emergence of the four forces and where they lead, it can be helpful to realize that the revolution we're experiencing today might be more the norm than the exception. American spirituality has always favored the direct over the inferred, the immediate over the gradual. It has always spilled over from the pews and pulpits into the towns and countrysides. In this context, we could consider this current moment as a great awakening in its own right, only this time. The mythical has been replaced by the empirical, from the Nevada desert and the disaster zones of the Gulf Coast and Afghanistan to the mountains of Utah and the sidewalks of Main Street. People are coming together to see for themselves, and what they're discovering is that there's more capacity, resilience, innovation, and creativity in all of us collectively than in any of us alone. That's as significant today as it was over 200 years ago. So even if there really is nothing new under the sun, each time it rises, it's still a sight to see.